Sure. I think what would be very different then is when a victim comes in to do an interview, rather than having to tell and retell the story, it becomes, tell me once. And it's not being interrupted with questions and details. It's like, let her piece it together. Give her the time and the space to do that. Take the notes, listen, and then cycle back to a few things. And again, always giving the victim a little time and a little space to piece it together. The main thing is that the change might be internally for law enforcement, to not treat that with such suspicion, to trust that the information has likely been encoded correctly, and therefore it is being recounted accurately. And so the job of the law enforcement is to listen to the story and then investigate it. I think any first responder who interacts with a victim, rape victim advocates. Rape victim advocates often, have to stand between law enforcement and the victim. The more that advocates know about this, the more that they can help educate their colleagues in law enforcement about why victims are behaving the way they do. Also for advocates, most rape crisis centers talk about in their training, victims have a wide variety of reactions. What this training does is it provides the science behind that. They've seen that, they've known that from their own practice. This is the science behind their practice. This is why victims have such high emotions, low emotions, flat emotions, and everything in between. So I think it's real important for advocates. It's also real important for medical practitioners, SANE nurses, ER nurses, physicians, anyone who's interacting with the victim in the medical context. Again, because the behaviors that victims exhibit to law enforcement, they exhibit to medical too, in terms of a fragmented story, flat affect, high affect, low affect, and again, medical personnel sometimes blame victims for the assault too, and they sort of get in that role confusion of thinking they're law enforcement. So in the part of medical care, they're not doing the medical piece. They feel like they're trying to help out the investigation. Not necessary. Their job is to attend to the victim's physical and emotional needs. And they can do that by using these same principles, time, space, little patience to let the victim tell the story in the way that she needs to, because that's going to be incredibly helpful for victims' health and well-being in the long run. The current work I'm doing right now is with the city of Detroit, which has a large number of untested sexual assault kits. And part of that action research project, which is funded by National Institute of Justice, is to understand how and why this happened. Why did we have so many untested sexual assault kits in Detroit, in Houston, in Los Angeles, in New York City, and in so many other jurisdictions we don't even know about? Well, one of the ways that we ended up with so many kits on shelves is because law enforcement didn't believe the victims. Why didn't they believe the victims? Because when the victim came in, they gave a story that to the law enforcement's ears sounded sketchy, fragmented, and the like. So what we've been able to do in Detroit is provide training to the Detroit practitioners on the neurobiology of trauma. So we did a little training with just a few of them. They said, this is fantastic. Now come do it again. So I did it for a larger group. And they said, you know what? Now we need to hear it for everybody. We need all patrol officers to hear this information. So over the course of several months, we're rolling out training in Detroit where all law enforcement officers in the Detroit Police Department are going to be having this training geared for patrol. What do you need to know when a victim first makes their report? Sex crimes unit investigators, what do you need to know? Command, what do you need to know about how long these cases take to successfully investigate and then ultimately send forward for prosecution? We're doing similar trainings on neurobiology of trauma with Detroit area advocates and the medical staff, again, with the goal of saturating the entire community of practitioners with this information so that they can understand victims' behavior and make attributions that are victim-centered, not victim-blaming. I think to study it, there's still a lot we don't know about the neurobiology of trauma, particularly why some victims have some reactions versus others. So I think there's a real need for just more basic research on the neurobiology of trauma and how it might manifest at times of an interview, a sexual assault medical forensic exam. This is still kind of a new science. In terms of disseminating it, again, I think it's about getting the information out to practitioners, not in a preachy way, which I think is I would be guilty of myself in terms of prior trainings I've done on false reports, but an education way of here's how information from another discipline might be useful to you. Here's how it can explain what you're seeing and how it can help you do your job more effectively. Because that's what law enforcement's interested in, is doing their job more effectively. And so that's how this information can be useful. So I think that we're thinking about dissemination in terms of trainings, where we get the information out and then they can practice it. It's very important for principals of adult learning to practice this information. So to have vignettes, to have opportunities to model this behavior, to work with more experienced officers, to talk with each other about how to do an interview in a victim-centered way.